Guy Martin is taking on four speed challengers that will test his skill, bravery,
what could possibly go wrong,
engineering expertise, and sheer ability to suffer. He and a friend have already smashed the world record for tandems by covering 565 miles in 24 hours. Now he's going solo and taking on extreme altitude in the world's toughest hill climb.
I'm not worried. Well, I am worried.
Pike's Peak, the second highest mountain in the Colorado Rockies. The summit is at an incredible 14,100 feet, far higher than any mountain found in the UK.
That's fairish. I mean, we've got Ben Nevis in England, that's about 4,000 feet. Yeah, air's a bit thin.
With a third less oxygen at the top than at sea level, this will be the extreme setting for a huge physical and technical challenge.
Good evening, everybody. This week there will be some rumbling on Pike's Peak as the 92nd running of the Pike's Peak International Hill Climb will run on Sunday.
Once a year, the twisty 12-mile road up the mountain is turned into a track. Specially built vehicles from all around the world are brought to race against the clock. Fastest to the top in each category wins.
You can race motorbikes. So, bit of me. It's a bit of me.
The Pike's Peak International Hill Climb is the motorsport equivalent of conquering Mount Everest. But with 156 treacherous turns and sheer drops, the risks don't come any higher. Miraculously, all the drivers survived these crashes with minimal injuries.
I'm going to try and give my best shot. A win would be fantastic. But whatever, it's not going to be easy. We've got a lot of unknowns.
This 92-year-old event, the second oldest race in America after the Indy 500, has never been won by a Brit. For a chance of victory, Guy will have to build a bespoke motorcycle that compensates for the way thin air saps power.
That genuinely scares me. No joking, that scares me. Keep it going.
He'll also have to exercise to breaking point so he can adapt to the effects of racing at altitude. And he'll have to train his brain to memorize every one of the 156 turns.
Left, right, past the ski center. If a lot of you think you're going to go off the end of the earth.
Finally, Guy and his best friend will embark on an epic road trip across America. and confront a series of problems that will threaten the whole attempt.
I'm trying to think of plan B, but at the minute plan B ain't turning up.
The Pike's Peak course starts in a wooded picnic area and ascends at a gradient of 10% to a ski center in the middle of the mountain. 10 near identical hairpin bends then sweep through barren rock to the summit, nearly 3 miles above sea level. French rally star Sebastien Loeb, the man fellow racers say is the greatest driver ever, is the record holder. In 2013, driving a full factory race car with 875 horsepower, his ice-cool driving helped him set a time of 8 minutes and 13 seconds. Sebastien is difficult to get hold of, but Guy manages to arrange a 20-minute meeting at his race team's Paris HQ.
I've drove here. What's it take me? Thick end of 11 hours to get here. Who would I drive 11 hours to meet? Sebastien Loeb, obviously Pike's Peak record holder. Can't think of anyone else. 9 times World Rally Champion. Legend. But also, he's a tradesman, he's an electrician. Which for me, makes him the ultimate legend.
Guy wants to know how best to tackle the track's baffling sequence of corners.
Trick. I've been making all these notes. If there is any areas to worry about, what for you is the trickiest bit? I think the hardest part for me is from the first hairpin to the ski centre. I just think there's a lot of stuff in between there that looks similar.
Yeah, here in this part for sure, that's the most difficult to remember because some are looking really the same. You have a hairpin right and then a long left, and one is a bit faster than the other one, and the third one is tightening. To remember that, it's difficult. Then you have to be careful on the top because it's bumpy.
Is it?
Yeah. Stay left and then go right and go around the bumps.
And what did you think to the danger?
For me, it was everywhere the same. You are not allowed to crash.
Anywhere.
It's so fast.
And did the altitude affect you?
I used oxygen.
Did you use oxygen?
Yeah.
Watching the videos, you can see he's got pipes into his helmet. I thought that was drinks. No, oxygen. Have you got any words of wisdom for me? How would you go about it?
Don't fall.
Yeah, don't fall.
Yeah?
Thanks very much.
Sebastien's big budget gave him a state-of-the-art car, a large support crew, and 3 weeks at Pike's Peak to memorize the track. But that's not for Guy. Ever the individual, he wants this to be a maverick solo effort and will build a special motorbike for the event at home.
I've owned this motorbike for 5 years, maybe more. 5, 6 years. I bought it as an unfinished project, and I thought when this motorbike is finished, this will be the best motorbike in the universe.
But Guy's motorcycle is a mongrel, made up of bits from lots of different bikes. He bought it from a specialist after falling in love with the quality of the welds. It echoes the look of American flat trackers. But with only a limited budget, a Pike's Peak record is out of the question. However, a coveted class win is possible if Guy can make the mongrel work.
this is on my head, and I don't want to let myself down. I don't want to let you down. And I want to prove we can do it.
The first Pike's Peak event was held in 1916. The so-called Race to the Clouds was a way of promoting the mountain as a tourist attraction. But the origins of this form of motorsport actually lie in Europe.
The French started hill climbing in 1898, but we don't want to know much about that. But hill climbing started in England in 1899, the year after. So yeah, hill climbing started in England in 1899. Very proud, very proud.
This is Shelsley Walsh in Worcestershire. It's a private road and a country estate, and is the world's oldest motorsport venue still in use. There are just 3 months until the Pike's Peak Challenge, and Guy's going to have his first experience of hill climbing at the sport's historic home.
It's fairly steep, it's fairly steep. I'm going to try and hit you. You ready? ...10% gradient. Look at that. Man down. Not a lot of traction. Doesn't bode well for later.
He'll use a motorbike at Pike's Peak. But today he'll practice in the Formula One car of hill climbing. An Empire Wraith. If he can get the hang of it in this, he'll be able to do it in anything. It uses a 1,000cc engine and can accelerate to 60 miles per hour in less than 2 seconds. Guy's mentor for the day is British hill climb champion, Scott Moran.
Today it's going to be particularly horrible.
Is that right?
It's going to be slippy.
What's the secret to it?
Hill climbing, you only get one go at it, so if you mess up a corner, you don't get another go.
Game over. Bloody ice, it's not very wide, is it?
You see how wide that is there? You see how wide the car is? You see, look at that there! You've got to be very precise. And accurate, and just it's really big concentration.
I'll have it right.
It'll be fine.
Not looking forward.
Yeah, it should be good.
Unlike normal races held over multiple laps against rivals, hill climbing is contested over just one run against the clock. It's the art of producing the perfect performance. The skill is in turning at exactly the right time, so you take the shortest possible route through every corner. It's the ultimate test of high-speed control and requires supreme concentration. Guy's first run leaves him lost for words.
Pushing the push, but he's coming in there, see? And then just a bit of a dent. He's mint.
Course knowledge is vital. Get a corner wrong here, and you're in a hedge. Get it wrong at Pike's Peak, and you're over a cliff edge.
You've got no rest. You're out of one corner, and you're right, you haven't got time to gather your thoughts for the next corner because you're on it. It's just much more than 100 miles an hour. My ass has been doing a bit of that.
Champion Scott can see a new rival emerging.
He's treated the car with, you know, maximum respect. He's built up to his speed. A bit more practice and keep you in trouble.
But despite doing several runs on the relatively short course, Guy still doesn't feel like he's learnt the track. This has huge implications for Pike's Peak.
Yeah, he's on my eyes. This is only half a mile, man. That's 12 miles. Starts, doesn't it? Starts. Starts. Thank you very much.
It's not just the length of the Pike's Peak track to consider, but the extreme altitude too. The next stage of Guy's preparations will push him to his physical limit. Guy Martin's taking his love of speed to America. This is the famous Pike's Peak hill climb in Colorado. Racing to nearly 3 miles above sea level on a mountain road with no runoff areas is notoriously dangerous. Thankfully, the drivers here escaped unharmed. Adding to the challenge is the fact Guy wants to tackle this project alone. Building the 1300cc motorcycle he'll compete on himself. Guy hopes to enter the exhibition class, the anything goes category for bikes with the biggest engines.
This is the rules. Right. 2014 Pike's Peak Challenge Exhibition Motorcycle Technical Inspection Form. And the rules are as follows. Neat and clean with race-ready appearance. Well, I think that's not a problem. Footrests must be blunt and folding. That might be a problem. We might need a bit of sweet talking there.
But the largest engineering challenge is to do with altitude. Internal combustion engines work by squeezing a mix of air and fuel in a cylinder, which a spark plug then ignites, driving a piston and powering the engine. But the lower oxygen content of Pike's Peak reduces how explosive that fuel-air mix is.
Pike's Peak is so high and the air is so thin that the standard internal combustion engine will lose 30% of its power. It's massive, isn't it? It's massive. But I know how to get around that. We're going to fit a turbo.
Turbochargers are small turbines which boost horsepower by increasing the pressure of air entering the cylinder. Forcing more air into the engine helps create a bigger bang. It's the same principle as stoking a fire by blowing on it.
Guy Martin, how you doing?
I've got a job for you.
So Guy takes his mongrel bike to have a turbocharger fitted by a specialist in Derbyshire.
Guy phoned me and said, "Hey John, I'm doing the Pike's Peak. How do you fancy it?" So I said, "Whatever it takes, we'll do it."
Go on, what do you think?
Wow. Tell you what, is there any bits that aren't modified?
No.
Plumbing this turbo into the bike will take days of precision welding. But while the turbo should take care of the bike's performance at altitude, Guy now needs to take care of his own. Just like an engine burns air with fuel to create energy, so does the human body. Every cell, from the brain to the bicep, is powered by combining oxygen with the body's fuel stores of carbohydrate, fat, and protein. Reduce the oxygen, and poor endurance, muscle weakness, and impaired brain function can follow. Altitude sickness symptoms can start at 8,000 feet. Guy will finish Pike's Peak at 14,000 feet. So he visits the University of Kent's Altitude Training Center.
Okay, I'm an airy bugger. Should be all right.
Professor Sam Macora, the Director of Research, is known around the world for his studies of endurance athletes and will test how much thin air will reduce Guy's performance.
Sounds like we're in NASA or something, but I'd like an oxygen monitor on my brain and on my muscles.
I'm sure there's a lot of preparation going into engines and chassis and tyres and petrol, you know, before the Pike's Peak. I don't think many boys will be going to this extent.
To begin with, Professor Sam monitors Guy during a 10-minute test in normal sea level air.
Keep pedaling.
He measures Guy's heart rate, rate of breathing, and reaction times.
Very good.
There is actually a measure of sustained attention, so being able to focus.
Come on, keep going, Guy. Let's be honest, was it one rocket science, was it? Until it was a bullseye that just flashed up on the screen, and when the bullseye flashed up, I pressed the button. And it came back with a time for how long it took for my finger to press the button from my brain recognising it.
Here we go. Okay, stop now. Stay on the bike.
Next, oxygen is reduced to simulate 14,000 feet.
Recording.
And the test is repeated.
Okay, cycle.
Everything was the same besides the oxygen content. What a difference that made.
Feel okay? Ah, there. Good. Come on, keep going, keep going. Very good.
Your body tries to compensate for the lack of oxygen in the atmosphere by increasing ventilation.
Keep focus, keep focus, keep going. Don't give up, don't give up.
You heard it, the state I was in, it was not pretty sounding, was it?
Come on, unless you feel very sick, we keep going, okay?
I was sort of struggling to see. As I was going that hard, I was having to breathe that heavy. But I'm backing out.
Come on, guy, come on. Yes, yes.
I was close to him just in case he passed out.
Keep going, keep going. Come on, let's feel. Come on.
Sounded like a murder scene.
Okay, stop.
Much longer, maybe another 30 seconds or a minute longer, I'd have passed out. But it was good. I like to be in that position where I'm pushing myself that hard.
The results are bad.
The red line is your ventilation.
Right.
That you are breathing in and out during the sea level simulated race.
Yes.
But then the blue line is like you will find at the very top of Pike's Peak. And as you can see, there is a massive difference
massive
in ventilation.
Difference, yeah.
And also it doesn't stabilize, it keeps going up.
Similar to the power loss in the engine, actually your fitness is reduced by 35% at the altitude that it will encounter at Pike's Peak.
If you went to Pike's Peak as you were today, you would really struggle.
But the biggest concern is Guy's reaction times. His brain's processing speed dropped 15%.
It's quite a big drop.
Is it?
Yes. This is a clear sign of what we call mental fatigue. That's going to be very bad. He has to be well accustomed to altitude so they can perform at his maximum.
Those cliff edges, I don't want a lot going wrong. And to be honest, I don't want to scratch my motorbike. So yeah, I don't want to be doing it. That bike's taken long enough to build.
Guy's best solution is to regularly exercise at altitude. The body compensates for the thinner air by producing more red blood cells to carry oxygen around the bloodstream. Most elite athletes travel abroad to train at height. But not Guy. Guy's going to make a room that can have its oxygen content lowered. A hypoxic chamber at home.
We're going to have a bit of a DIY. A bit of a DIY, dear.
He lines his walls and ceiling with polythene.
Strong stuff, man.
To make the room airtight.
Kinky beggar at number two. You see what he's doing? Multi-alley heavy-o things, huh?
Then he rigs up two hypoxic generators.
Oh, they're on wheels.
To reduce the amount of oxygen in the room from 21 to 16%. When the room is equivalent to the thin air at Pike's Peak, a match won't burn.
Spot on. Trained away in it, sweated a bit, but I'm still a bit hot and bothered now. It's not a pleasant experience. This is perfect now. I have got my own hypoxic chamber at home, and there's no better way to acclimatise to Pike's Peak than at home.
Guy trains in there day after day after day. But it will all be for nothing if his bike isn't up to scratch. Back in Derbyshire, the turbo has been attached along with an exquisite handmade exhaust that has been carefully engineered to fit in an impossible gap.
Bloody hell, man, she's tight, isn't she? That there lies the problem. Our tooling on our £250,000 tube bender has a given radius. That's our radius.
Yeah.
But of course, we need way tighter than that. So essentially, all you can do is lobster back it, basically, little cheese wedges.
Weld each one.
And weld every last one together. That would not look out of place in a Formula One pit. It's a work of art. Yeah, it's just trick.
Guy wants this to be a home-built project, so he's determined to finish the bike by himself.
I'm not worrying. Well, I am worrying. There's a lot of stuff. Oil core mounting, make the subframe, make the wiring loom, get it running right, sort the clutch out. The clock's ticking.
Guy works relentlessly. He only stops to check for vital news about the bike's fuel tank.
There's Paddy, my mate, legend, paints me helmets. Tank is done. I was on it till 3:30 a.m. !!
Guy's friend Paddy, bricklayer, fireman and spray painter, arrives with a freshly painted tank.
Don't drop this one, guy, please.
It's the last piece of the puzzle.
You hold it up, man, let me plug them in.
That's right, guy, take it on it.
That's mega, mate.
5 years after he first bought the bike, the time has finally come to see if she'll start.
I'll try. Thanks, my woman.
It's definitely neutral, it can go take off and pick him down there, isn't it?
Genuinely scares me. No joking, that scares me. You stood at the Pike's Peak, you tell me that's not going to scare you. If you had to go to the Pike's Peak on that. I'm shaking.
Spoke of lambs work.
Yeah. Got lambs work.
Oh, I've never seen like this before. Well, no, I haven't had anything to scare you.
I'm shaking. I'm genuinely shaking.
The bike works. But Guy's created a monster, which he'll have to tame if he's to win the toughest hill climb in the world. Guy Martin is taking on Pike's Peak in Colorado. The 1 mile vertical ascent is the hardest hill climb in the world. It's never been won by a Brit, so Guy's enlisted some last-minute help. His former Isle of Man TT mechanic and old friend, Cammy.
Is she running? Yeah? Yeah, she's running. Right, it's me. It's Cammy.
Hello,
Cammy. Cameron Whitworth. Cameron Whitworth.
Cameron John Whitworth III. Rank... mechanic. Number, I don't think I've got a number, have I? How would the add-on?
I did build the bike, but I need someone to fix it, so...
Yeah.
So but he's alright, Cammy's legend. He's got 17 TT wins to his name. Yeah. So he knows what he's doing. He knows how to wheel the spanner. But just a big moment, the bike. Yeah, the bike's an unknown. The track's an unknown, the event's an unknown, the altitude's an unknown, we're an unknown, with Americans. So, yeah.
Anything could happen. Absolutely anything. He's not your normal kind of person, and he comes to mind and he's not had a shower for 5 days, and he borrows me underwear, and he's had the same pair of boxers on for 5 days, but that's him. You'll never change him, because if you try to change him, it'll do it even more.
The first task, collect the motorbike and hope it's been safely air freighted.
I'm nervous. I've not seen it for over a week now. Damn man.
That's some boss, isn't it?
That's a big old boss. Come on, let's have a look.
Yeah.
Everything needs to be loaded into their rental van.
Good job we had that Mexican breakfast.
The spare parts and tools have arrived intact.
Hey Elvis, we're gonna win this race.
Are you coming down, fellas?
Yeah, go on, Mike.
Watch your toes.
But how's the bike?
She's there, Chief, and she's not falling over. No.
That's a bitchin' bike.
It's a bitchin' bike.
It's a bitchin' bike.
Said with a straight face. I like it.
Oh!
Go on.
Yeah.
Guy and Cammy head for the famous Route 66.
This one, or next one?
It's a slight forking road here.
It's next one, not this one at all, it's next one.
They're 400 miles from Pike's Peak.
We're doing 60, what's he doing? Yeah. What's he doing? That's more than our lad.
Yeah.
Bloody hell.
Rubber duck.
First, they're off to meet Albuquerque's most famous son, American racing legend, Bobby Unser.
He's the only man to win the Indy 500 in three decades.
Three different decades, that's pretty impressive.
Three different decades. 60s, 70s, 80s, he's won the Indy 500.
And he's won Pike's Peak.
He's won Pike's Peak 13 times.
Nobody has won Pike's Peak more times than Bobby Unser, and Guy and Cammy want to show their respect.
That's the bell, eh?
Hello there, Bobby.
How are you?
How are you, Bobby? I'm Guy.
Hi, Guy.
Pleased to meet you, mate. This is me, mate, Cammy.
Are you all right?
How are you?
Sure. Pleased to meet you.
Come on in.
We've been told you're the man
Wipe
to come and see. I'll take him off, mate. Thanks very much. How are you keeping, mate?
Huh?
How are you keeping?
Good.
Yeah?
Good.
You're looking well.
Do you think it's a dangerous race?
It's very dangerous. Mm. Yeah. If you get rain or if you get hail, which is very common up there.
Is it?
The scariest part is going to be maybe three-fourths of the way up.
Yeah.
What they call the W's.
The W's.
Yeah, the W's.
Right.
The roads go up bare side of a mountain.
Yes.
And they have to go up like this.
Switchbacks.
Switchbacks.
Yeah.
And then it'll go down a little bit.
Yes.
Into a place called Bottomless Pit.
Mm-hmm.
Bottomless Pit, you don't want to go off there. It's a bad place to go.
Yeah.
If you do, you need wings, because you're going to be a long time before you hit the ground. And remember another thing. The road will never leave the mountain. Think about this. That the mountain is on the left.
Yes.
The road isn't going to go out into the sky to the right. No. So don't
That's
be looking
advice.
For the road.
That
to go
is
there.
Good advice.
Yeah. Yeah.
The road follows the mountain. Hey, Bobby, you're the man. You're the man. Hey, Bobby, thank you very much for your time, mate. Thank
you
very much.
Came by.
The road trip continues.
Oh, I'm out window.
V8.
I'm doing about 9.5 to the gallon. We're just going to Colorado Springs. How long do you reckon? Colorado Springs.
Colorado Springs, about 6 hours, I want to say.
6 hours?
The journey is over. The Pike's Peak Mountain awaits.
Yeah, which one is it? Bit of an hill, innit?
Yeah.
Any bit of an hill? So let's get cracking. Come on.
The Pike's Peak Highway is a public road, so the four practice sessions have to take place in the early hours. Guy and Cammy have to set up their makeshift pits before sunrise. There's no big budget race team to help here.
5 to 4, Tuesday morning. Well, what are we? about 14,000 foot up here. Top section, first practice, top section track. Yeah, look at that. You wouldn't think, would you? Minus 0.2.
It's bearable. But I'm from Manchester, so it's not that bad.
Oh, the rotty finger of dawn is breaking.
Mechanic Cammy sends his best friend off with the other competitors for the very first run on the homemade bike.
You know, when he disappears, you never know, but we always hope for the best. You know, it's a serious thing, isn't it? It's not my playground. Yeah, stomach's dropped a bit, yeah. Looking for a portaloo, but there ain't none. So, no, we'll see. Anyway, they're back now, so off we go.
Guy returns safely, but the bike didn't perform as expected. They go for a second run to try and find out why the bike isn't accelerating properly. But things go even worse. The motorcycle grinds to a complete halt.
They stop.
The practice session has been a disaster. There are only 3 days of practice left to fix the problem.
A cup of tea.
With no workshop, the duo try and fix the bike in a variety of car parks. Until rain stops play. Winning Pike's Peak is beginning to seem impossible. Guy spends every spare minute trying to memorize the Pike's Peak course. For the past 6 months, he's watched videos of Pike's Peak, trying to learn the 12-mile sequence of 156 turns off by heart.
It goes right, left, yeah, and then there's a bit of a right kink right at the end of the straight.
Correct.
Out the left hand hairpin. And it goes left, right, left, and then long right past the ski centre.
Correct.
If Guy misremembers just one corner, it could be fatal. So to help him cement his knowledge, he takes a trip up the mountain during the day.
Cammy's not here. Cammy's scared of heights. Double-eyed lad from Manchester, but he's scared of heights. Don't say that. So yeah, the start line's here. You set off there, you go through the batteries, and it goes, you'll see my memory now, won't you? It goes right, straightens up, goes right again, straightens up, goes right again. So I'm gonna come out of here into the longest left-hander. It looks like the end of the earth. You're gonna have to run over to the right-hand side, but don't really tip in. Just stay out wide, stay out wide, stay out wide. But you think you're gonna go off the end of the earth. I don't need to be crashing up there, really, do I? So it goes right, left, tight right, but don't go on for a long time. What it does, it goes into an hairpin. It goes into an hairpin, I got that wrong.
Thank you.
again on your beautiful mountain, and thank you that we're alive and breathing, and keep us away from the guardrails with your guardian angels on us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ride is briefing. Apparently, don't stop in the picnic area. If you do, don't stay there for long, because there's a bear. A real life one, not the cuddly ones that you win on the grabbing machines at Blackpool. That's all you need.
Once again, Guy's temperamental bite cuts out. The team are feeling like underdogs.
This is what we're on about with, like, Guy and Cammy against the world. Like, we're here. Jeans on from last night, full of oil. And over there you have 27 members of Factory Ducati team in their articulated truck with all the spanners lined out like it's a car boot sale.
With the bike continuing to run roughly, Guy attempts to reprogram the bike's electronic brain and alter how much fuel it burns.
These are just numbers. They just tell it's had more fuel to make the engine run cooler and make the engine run smoother.
It doesn't work. The bike still coughs and splutters. The mystery problem could scupper everything Guy's worked for, but spirits remain high.
Everyone's happy.
I'm still smiling.
He's still smiling. I like a challenge. And yeah, this is proving to be a right challenge. But let's get some brake clean around that clutch.
Do you ride the bike?
No, not in a million years. I ain't even sat on it. It's gotta be mad. I mean, you gotta be mad to own a bike like that, to stick a turbo on it, the fast enough as he is, and then to come up here. I mean, we drove up here. It's frightening, isn't it? Going round them herping bends, and you're just shooting up, like, and it's like that, though. Just drops off the end of the world. And he's like, oh, yeah, I'll tip it in. And you're like, yeah, I got my knee down. I wouldn't even look down, never mind get my knee down. Do you know what I mean?
The bike still has an intermittent fault that makes the engine cut out unexpectedly, leaving Guy stranded on the course. But at least he hasn't crashed. One fellow competitor misjudges a switchback bend and takes out a rider below. A race truck driver is lucky to walk away after careering over the side of the mountain. The thought of running a malfunctioning bike on this treacherous course plays heavily on the team's minds.
At the minute, we're very sceptical because the bike, the way it is not really safe to run. We don't want to put anyone in danger, especially Guy. There's a gremlin somewhere, and we can't find the gremlin. So at the minute, we're just sat here, just trying to think of plan B, but at the minute, plan B ain't turning up.
They decide simply to ride the bike using half throttle.
Nothing stupid.
It seems to work. Below 100 miles per hour, the bike runs more predictably, indicating a faulty fuel valve can't deliver enough fuel at higher speeds. A replacement is unavailable.
I know what I'm dealing with now. I know the tools I've got. I know I can ride to its strengths. I can account for its weaknesses. Is it safe? Probably not. Probably not. Probably not.
Nobody knows if Guy will finish the race safely. 3 months preparation might be all for nothing.
America's mountain, breathtaking in its beauty. It shows no mercy towards those who dare to race to the top. Don't miss the 90-second running of the Pikes Peak International Hill Climb, June 29th. Who will challenge? Who will dominate? Watch the best drivers and riders in the world battle the most challenging mountain in America. Race week fun for the whole family. It's the Race to the Clouds, the 90-second running of the Pikes Peak International Hill Climb.
Good night.
What do you think of the mountain so far?
Yes, all right.
The day before the Pikes Peak race, all the competitors display their machinery in downtown Colorado Springs.
What do you think is going to be back?
I think it's awesome.
Yeah.
Someday he's going to weld like that.
No, I'm not.
Guy and his bike cause quite a stir.
Are you married?
No.
You got a boyfriend?
No.
You haven't? Yeah. Can I catch up with you later on?
Yeah.
Go for a pint?
Yes.
Yeah? Right, I'll see you in a bit then, eh?
Okay.
Yeah? Spot on. Spot on. See you in a bit.
Alright.
Cheers, mate. Oh, she could be the future wife. I got up late this morning. Well, it's not this morning, was it? I got up at midnight.
The Pikes Peak hill climb is so popular that crowds start pouring onto the mountain 6 hours before the racing starts.
Training seems to have worked alright. Altitude's not affecting me. Brain's alright. Track knowledge alright. Bike is... We always knew it was going to be an unknown. We hadn't taken the easy option. It's turned out it wasn't the easy option. It's causing a right load of grief. We've got to race. We've got to race. Whatever. Come hell or high water, we're going to race. I've had a blurb in and I've just said, you know, we've all seen how dangerous it can be up there on them earthen bends. I know he wants to put on a good show, get a good time, but, you know, we all want to go home and end it there together. Looking forward to it. Yeah? We're on it. Fact, it's only 3 o'clock there now. We're not really going to do anything till 7:30. So I might get 40 winks. 40 winks.
Guys racing in the so-called exhibition class for bikes with the biggest engines. His chief rival is Yasuo Arai. The experienced Japanese competitor has been fast throughout practice. Guy gets one shot.
Back behind the gate, guys. Here we go.
There are no second chances.
Nothing stupid.
On the timing screen. Guy is off to a good start and faster through the first checkpoint than in any of his practices.
slow knife. That's decent, that.
Amongst the melee of the start line, Chief Rival R.I. sets off on the 183.
So we need to wait for number 183 now.
The timing reveals R.I. is faster.
He's 2.5 seconds quicker.
Into the middle sector and still riding round the bike's problems. But Arai matches him.
183, Arai. Still 2 seconds up on us. I think Guy's best bit is going to be like the top bit. That's more your TT, it's like Windy Corner. He's alright about it. Then he could like pull some time back on him.
But then the timing screens fail.
Oh, come on! There's no timing. Oh, we ain't got any idea what's going on.
Everyone is in the dark. And now Guy's in the most difficult part of the course. Above the tree line, in the thinnest air, and with the biggest drops. It's down to him to ride as fast as he dare and hope the bike holds out.
The way to deal with a race like that is to deal with it in the way I dealt with it. Ride till this point. Brake at this point. Hit this apex. Give it a gear at that point. Let go of the throttle at that point. Yeah, there's no panicking going on inside the helmet. Because I'm 100% confident in where I'm going. That was only the case because I put the F in. You want to get out what you put in. And by me putting the F in, allowed my race run to be calm, which it was. That race run was the calmest moment of the whole trip.
Despite the calmness, Guy's upset the bike wasn't working properly.
I got to the top and I was a bit peed off. Just because I knew I could have gone so much faster.
All eyes turn to R.I. finishing on the 183. The clock stops. Has Guy done enough to win?
Yeah, he won.
Yeah! He's won by a second, from R.I.
Yes!
Congratulations! Yeah, cheers!
On a homemade bike that is basically broken, Guy has overcome the 2 second gap at halfway to become the first British winner at Pike's Peak by a solitary second. And he has no idea.
I don't know. I didn't want any time because I wasn't bothered. I just was not bothered. But you made me go find the time. Where was I in the exhibition? The top.
was a quick first exhibition.
First
exhibition.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, guys.
I thought I ran like a bag of spanners, but we was first in class, so I'm happy. I'm happy. Now we're talking. Man's got off here. Man's got off here. Cheers, mate. Cheers. Thanks very much. What an adventure. That's the best thing in motorbike I've ever done. Like, without being... Best thing in motorbike I've ever done. Means.
We won, chief.
Spot on, mate. Yeah, well done, mate. 100%. Sat up here with a beer, looking over the world, mate. Mega. Mega. Thanks very much.
Yeah, that's certainly one to add to the CV, lad, that.
Cheers, mate. Thanks very much.
And the winner of the exhibition class, with a time of 11:32.55, Guy Martin.
Cheers, man. Thanks very much. Cheers, up. Cheers, mate. Thanks very much. I'm just a bit shy in a situation like that. And I could come in with a trophy. He's put a massive effort in, so he deserved it. I was genuinely over the moon.
It was like the Oscars, wasn't it?
Next time, Guy will attempt his most dangerous challenge to date. Balancing on the edge of control as he tries to beat the hovercraft speed world record.
Oh my god, it's just gone up in here!
Bite-sized and exclusive to Shorts on 4OD, Guy Martin's passion for life focuses on his time at the Isle of Man TT and his usually off-limits life. Next tonight, Carrie acts on a tip while Saul calls in a favour from a friend in the Pakistani military in Homeland.